Macmillan Audio presents Franklin and Eleanor, An Extraordinary Marriage by Hazel Rowley. Read for you by Tavia Gilbert.
I can honestly say, though I'll be thought biased, that the best museum I've ever visited anywhere in the world is the Franklin D. Roosevelt Presidential Library and Museum in Hyde Park, 2 hours north of New York City by train or car, in the beautiful Hudson Valley. It's a large country estate with several different dwellings, and it takes a whole day to go through it properly. There's the big house, where FDR was born in an upstairs bedroom in 1882, and where he brought his bride, Eleanor, for the first week of their honeymoon in 1905. Although it belonged to his mother, Sarah Delano Roosevelt, FDR always regarded it as his true home. The house has been preserved as it was at the time of his mother's death in September 1941. In the front entrance, you see a glass cabinet with some of the birds Franklin shot and stuffed in his adolescence. Scattered throughout the house are ornaments from China, where Sarah Delano spent several years in her childhood, while her father made a fortune from the opium trade. There are paintings of ships everywhere. The most imposing room in the house is the library, with its handsome wooden panels, vast bookcases, fireplaces, and magnificent views of woodland and mountains, the Catskills across the Hudson River. Not far from the house, near the stables, is the Rose Garden where FDR and Eleanor are buried, side by side. A short walk away is the museum, a Dutch fieldstone building, which contains fascinating photos, letters, mementos, and historical film footage. Eleanor Roosevelt's cottage, Val Kill, 2 miles through the woods in a minibus, looks from the outside like the factory it once was. Inside, it is humbly cozy, a maze of guest rooms looking out onto forest, the stream, and a pond. It was here that Eleanor entertained people from all walks of life, from annual picnics for underprivileged Negro boys from the Wiltwyck School for Boys, to some of the most important world leaders of the time, including John F. Kennedy, Pandit Nehru, Marshal Tito, and Haile Selassie. The same guided tour takes you over rough winding roads to Top Cottage, one of the highest points in Dutchess County, inaccessible in winter because of the ice, where FDR liked to take tea with friends on the porch, enjoying the rustle of leaves in the breeze. When I first went to Hyde Park, the summer after I moved to New York, I thought I already knew a lot about the Roosevelts. But as our cheerful little group drove from Sarah's gloomy, cluttered Victorian mansion to FDR's simple stone dwelling among the dogwoods and pines, I became freshly fascinated by this couple and their remarkable lives. So, it seemed, was everyone else, since there were lots of questions, particularly about the Roosevelts' relationship. One person asked if there was a good book on the Roosevelt marriage. "Nothing recent," the guide replied. She mentioned Eleanor and Franklin, 1971, by Joseph Lash, a close friend of Eleanor's, and Doris Kearns Goodwin's No Ordinary Time, Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt, The Home Front in World War II, 1994, which focuses on the final 5 years in the Roosevelts' 40-year marriage. There were plenty of books in the New Deal store, she said, next to Mrs. Nesbitt's cafe in the Welcome Center. It was sunset by the time I drove back to Manhattan, with the seed of my next book in my head. This is the story of the Roosevelt marriage, its evolution from conventional Victorian family into the bold and radical partnership that made Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt go down in history as one of the most inspiring couples of all times. In the face of trials that would test any marriage, FDR's domineering mother, the onset of FDR's polio, the strains of 12 years in the White House, the burden of leading the American people through the 20th century's most traumatic catastrophes, FDR and Eleanor emerged triumphant. As president and first lady, they commanded respect at home and abroad. In the eyes of the free world, their partnership came to represent the ideals of Western liberal democracy. Were they not a model of equality, openness, and freedom of speech? When I told the chief archivist at the FDR Library that I was researching the Roosevelt marriage, he remarked, "A touchy subject." The marriage raised eyebrows in the Roosevelts' lifetimes, and since Eleanor's death, details have emerged which makes it more controversial than ever. Was it a good relationship, or was it flawed, as most Roosevelt scholars seem to think? Did Franklin and Eleanor have affairs? Was Eleanor a lesbian? It is astounding, when you think about it, that the Roosevelts' marriage is still shrouded in mystery and secrecy. From March 1905, when the bride was given away by her father's brother, President Theodore Roosevelt, until the death of Franklin Roosevelt in April 1945, at the beginning of his fourth term as president, this marriage was played out in the public gaze. FDR was the longest-serving president in American history, and yet even as the most famous couple in the nation, living under relentless scrutiny, the Roosevelts managed to maintain their unorthodox private lives, keeping major details hidden from the public, and sometimes from each other. Surprisingly, the fresh material that has come our way in the past few years has had remarkably little impact on what I call the standard narrative, by which I mean the story most of us think we know. According to this version, Eleanor's discovery of FDR's affair with Lucy Mercer in 1918 was a dramatic turning point, after which the marriage degenerated, with Franklin and Eleanor keeping up a gracious façade, all the while finding their escape in politics and close friends. This, at least, is the basic plot, and beyond this, everyone takes sides. Some see Franklin as the long-suffering partner, while others claim it was Eleanor. FDR's partisans, usually male, paint a picture of Eleanor that is one-dimensional to the point of misogyny. Eleanor Roosevelt's supporters, usually female, paint FDR as a slippery egotist. Just after Eleanor's death, Martha Gellhorn, who as a young left-wing journalist was a frequent guest at the White House in the late 1930s, told Adlai Stevenson, "All the weeping for Mrs. R. should have been done years ago, starting 70 years ago. I always thought she was the loneliest human being I ever knew in my life, and so used to bad treatment, beginning with her mother, and going right on, that it did not occur to her to ask for anything for herself. Not ever. I never liked the president, nor trusted him as a man because of how he treated her." Bizarre though this sounds coming from Gellhorn, who had been married to the famously macho Ernest Hemingway, the ferocious taking of sides, as well as this view of the marriage as a kind of tragic compromise patched together by two lonely people, has lasted almost half a century. I find this an absurdly conventional and condescending interpretation of one of the most interesting and radical marriages in history. In my view, the Roosevelts' bond was political in every sense of the word. They were two politically astute people, very tough underneath their vulnerabilities, who knew exactly what they needed in order to do their best work. They were real radicals in their different ways. Their courage and boldness in their public and private lives was remarkable. Their marriage did not evolve by itself. They consciously shaped the way it changed. It was a joint endeavor, a partnership that made it possible for the Roosevelts to become the spectacular and influential individuals they became. The extended family of close companions were not there to paper over the holes in the marriage. They were embraced as part of it. Both FDR and Eleanor had other intimate companions, other loves. They accepted this about each other. It was part of their generous spirit. I do not want to idealize the marriage. Of course it was a shock for Eleanor to come across Lucy Mercer's love letters to Franklin. And of course the marriage was not without problems. But it was precisely the troubles, trials, and conflicts that brought out the strength, courage, and radicalism of these two people. Their bond was strong enough to withstand betrayal, polio, and the White House. Their affection and tenderness for each other shines through their correspondence. In the months after the Lucy Mercer affair, FDR still called his wife Dearest Babs. She called him Dearest Honey. It was the tragedy that occurred on Campobello Island in the summer of 1921 that dramatically transformed the Roosevelt marriage. At the age of 39, FDR was stricken with polio. Never again would he be able to stand up without help. Never again would he be able to take a single step on his own. He needed constant attendance. His mother wanted him to retire to Hyde Park, which would have meant sinking into gentrified invalidism. Eleanor urged him, despite the immense obstacles, to keep up his political career. From then on, she played a crucial role as his partner. She could not have done it without Lewis Howe. The little man had been FDR's closest advisor since FDR entered politics in 1911. During the anguished vigil by FDR's bedside, and in the following years, when FDR was struggling to come to terms with the changed circumstances of his life, Howe entered the marriage in a major way. For months at a time, while Franklin was in the South with his secretary, Missy LaHand, doing his utmost to find himself again, Lewis Howe lived with Eleanor and the children in the Roosevelt family home, looking after FDR's work and political interests. For 7 years, Howe collaborated with Eleanor almost as much as with FDR. Their combined talents, along with their deliberate cover-up of the extent of FDR's disability, resulted in a spectacular triumph. In 1928, FDR was elected governor of New York. In November 1932, at the age of 50, FDR was elected president of the United States. In the meantime, the Roosevelt marriage had become a community. There had always been more than two in this union. Sarah Delano Roosevelt loomed large from the beginning. And after polio, several close companions entered the picture. The Roosevelts believed in community, neighbors, and friends. These would become key words in FDR's speeches over the years. Their houses were like residential hotels, with family and close friends staying for weeks or months at a time. The question of extramarital relationships has been a thorny subject in Roosevelt scholarship over the years. FDR was an intensely private man who was a master of concealment. He never began the autobiography he intended to write in his Hyde Park retirement years. His letters, all but the most private, dictated to secretaries, were written with the knowledge that they would one day go to the FDR library at Hyde Park. Eleanor Roosevelt's 3-volume autobiography is a study in evasion. Even with her closest friends, Eleanor said what she felt she ought to feel, rather than what she felt. The Roosevelt companions were admirably discreet. In contrast with today's kiss-and-tell indiscretions, most took the view that their secrets should go with them to the grave. The gaps in the record, the silences, the evasions and distortions provide a challenge to Roosevelt biographers. But enough has survived to give us a sense of the Roosevelts' intimate world. As with all politicians, we need to read between the lines. FDR could not have faced a more challenging presidency. He entered the White House in March 1933 at the depth of the Depression, and 6 weeks after Hitler became chancellor in Germany. In his inaugural address, FDR told the American people, "The only thing we have to fear is fear itself." From his very first day in the White House, he introduced major reforms. Conservatives hated him. Vested interest groups despised him. FDR did not give in. "I welcome their hatred," he said. In September 1939, war broke out in Europe, and in December 1941, the United States joined the war. Throughout the war, indeed throughout his years in the presidency, FDR radiated sublime confidence. The uncomplaining way he surmounted his physical handicap, his handsome face, ready smile, and soaring eloquence went straight to people's hearts. Eleanor Roosevelt became the most outspoken first lady this country has known. The most active, the most independent, the most courageous, the most admired, the most controversial, the most savagely mocked. She dealt, as a woman in the political arena, with constant condescension. Any woman in public life needs to develop skin as tough as rhinoceros hide, she said. Throughout the world, FDR and Eleanor were widely viewed as embodying the best of the American character. In their personal and political lives, they were idealistic, energetic, hardworking, courageous, and deeply democratic. Eleanor put FDR in contact with the people more than any other president's wife has ever done. To their dinner table, to their picnics, she brought the world. FDR, the man at the helm, knew what he owed to Eleanor. She was not the woman behind the scenes. She was the woman on the scene, the woman the press liked to joke was ubiquitous. Eleanor Roosevelt could not have been the woman she was without Franklin, but nor could Franklin Roosevelt have been the man he was without Eleanor. Together, they made possible what to most people would have seemed impossible. Eleanor Roosevelt once said, "You must do the things you think you cannot do." She did. He did. As a couple, they both did. 1. Cousins in Love, 1902 to 1905. They were cousins, fifth generation once removed. Their common ancestor, Klaas van Rozenvelt, had emigrated from Holland around 1650 and settled in New Amsterdam, as New York City was still called at that time. On American shores, the family name, which meant Field of Roses, had been changed to Roosevelt, but the descendants still pronounced the first syllable Rose, in deference to their Dutch heritage. However the name was pronounced, there was no ambiguity about its standing. Roosevelt was a pedigree name among the New York aristocracy. Indeed, when Franklin and Eleanor happened to find themselves on the same train in the summer of 1902, it was the most famous name in the country. The cousins were on the New York Central, traveling north from New York City along the east bank of the Hudson River. Franklin was strolling through the coach car when he spotted Eleanor, sitting with her maid. They had not seen each other for 3.5 years. The last occasion had been a family Christmas party held in Orange, New Jersey, at the grand country home of Corrine Roosevelt Robinson, the little sister of Anna, Theodore, and Elliot Roosevelt. At 14, Eleanor looked gangly and awkward in a short white dress with blue bows on each shoulder, a hand-me-down from one of her maternal aunts. Seeing her looking lost on the sidelines, Franklin went up and asked her to dance. "I still remember my gratitude," Eleanor wrote years later, in This Is My Story. At that Christmas party in 1898, the family had been celebrating Theodore Roosevelt's latest triumphs. In August, he had returned from the Spanish-American War, covered in glory for his exploits as commander of the cavalry regiment, the Rough Riders. Theodore Roosevelt had become a popular hero, the man everyone talked about. In November, he had been elected governor of New York. That Christmas, he was about to move his family to Albany. Since then, Theodore Roosevelt's rise had been meteoric. A progressive Republican, he was governor of New York for 2 years and then was elected vice president under President William McKinley. In September 1901, when McKinley was shot by an anarchist in Buffalo, New York, Theodore Roosevelt became the youngest president in American history at the age of 42. To Eleanor, Uncle Ted might be the most famous man in the land, but above all, he was the elder brother of the man she would idealize to her dying day, her father Elliot, who had died when she was 9. Uncle Ted, a sentimental man, often told her that he loved her like a daughter. Eleanor found him a little overpowering. During her adolescence, when she made her annual...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.